of rising Asian interests in Africa, problems, prospects, and challenges. They are all set, and we are right on time. So I will invite the first presenter, who has 15 minutes, to give us the gist of his paper. Let me invite Felix Kituru. Kituru, you have the floor.
Some of these were acting as money lenders to the traders there, and then with the coming of the British, because again the two countries, India and Kenya, were colonized by the same power that is Britain, the British government brought in some Indians to come and help in the construction of the rail line, because Africans were not really interested in providing this kind of paid labor. By the virtue of the fact that at this time, in the 1890s, Africans did not appreciate the money that was being paid out by the British, and therefore they brought in contract laborers from India, and some of these people settled in that region, and we are seeing that ever since, relations were built between these people and the African communities in Kenya, and that these links have continued to grow over time. And we note that again, during the freedom struggle in Kenya, some of the Indians participated by way of collaborating with the Kenyans. We have trade unionists like the late Mackenzie, who played a very important role in training Africans on trade unionism, because the Indians were ahead of the Kenyans. And we also have others, including business people like AM Kibaji, GM. AM Kibaji, Ali Bai, Kibanji was the pioneer of one of the dealers in Kenya that is still operational, of course, now is being run by other people. That is the East African Standard, which is going on up to the time. It's one of the major dealers. It was started by this man, again from India, and many of these people collaborated with Africans in the struggle for national, for our freedom. And notably, Tom Boyer, the late Tom Boyer, was inspired by the late Indian Prime Minister, that is Jawaharlal Nehru, in the struggle for independence. And therefore, we are saying that these historical relationships have been very, very important in building other nations after independence. We are also noting that quite a number of Kenyans have been educated in India, and therefore, even in terms of culture, even in terms of doing things, there is a lot that Kenyans have learned from the Indians, and therefore, this exposes them to trade with these people of Asia. Now, there is a statement by the first Indian Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru, that has continued to inspire people of Africa to continue relating with India. And I quote, he stated that Africa's significance to India stems from the fact that though separated by the Indian Ocean from us, it is, in a sense, our next door neighbor. Now, that statement carries a lot of weight in the sense that Africans do not look at Indians the way they look at other powers in the world. They look at India as a neighbor. Now, we are also saying that many African countries were also colonized by the Western powers, and therefore, there is a sense in which they think that they share this history of colonialism with a country like India, and therefore, this softens their relations and has predisposed them to trade with these people from Asia more, you know, more positively. Now, what are the commodities or what are the exports that people of India get from Kenya? Now, a glance at these exports from Kenya shows that the exports from Kenya. We take things like cashew nuts. These are commodities, or what you may call primary commodities, things like leather, etc. Well, at the same time, we mainly get from them things like machine tools, things like pharmaceuticals, and notably, the pharmaceuticals that are coming from India are far much cheaper than those that are being produced by the Western companies. And because of this, and because we are talking about a country that is struggling, a country with a struggling economy, then this predisposes the Kenyans, of course, to want to build more or to continue trading with the Indians. But at the same time, we are noting that from the 1980s, the scenario changed. It is true that the scenario changed. And quite a number of Indian companies, large companies dealing with information technology, like the SR Group, companies dealing with motor vehicles, began to make inroads. For example, the Tata conglomerate in India was able to sell the Mahindra vehicle to the government of Kenya. And recently, Bharti Airtel, it has revolutionized the cell phone connectivity in the region. Since last year, to make a call from Kenya, after this company invested in the region, to make a call from Kenya to the United States, cost only 3 Kenya shillings. Now, for your information, one US dollar is about is equivalent to about 84 Kenya shillings. Now, before last year, to make a phone call to the US in Kenya, you needed to spend almost about 50 Kenya shillings. So we are saying from about 50 Kenya shillings, it has gone down to about 3 shillings. And therefore, some of these factors, of course, will definitely continue to make people of the region look more favorably towards countries like India because they feel some of these benefits more or less almost immediately. I have said something, I have also said something about the benefits from the pharmaceutical industries. When somebody suffers from a kidney problem in the region, instead of being taken to Britain or to the US, the people there find it easier to send this patient to India, because this will cost, the cost of something like a kidney transplant will cost maybe like 5% of what this will cost when you send the patient, say, to a hospital here in the United States. And all these factors have made people in the region to continue trading and wanting to trade more with some of those countries in the AI. So the money here, the value for their money is very, very important. But at the same time, we observe that there are quite a number of challenges, especially when you talk with the small-scale traders, those large conglomerates, those ones, they are able to navigate. They are able to negotiate their way with the government, and they are able to get tax waivers, etc. But with those small traders, whether from India or from Kenya, they encounter a lot of challenges. It is a challenge for them to pay the visa fees. It is a challenge for them even to pay for their transport, in spite of the fact that there is, for example, the Kenya Airways does daily flights from Kenya to India, and the cost is quite reasonable, but for these small traders, it is still a problem, and therefore that still leaves giant companies to make a kill out of this trade. And finally, in terms of conclusion, then we ask what is the way forward. But even in terms of asking what is the way forward, we observe that that these historical relations have been very key, very, very primary in promoting this trade, these connections between the people of Asia and people of Africa, and the fact that India is able to produce, is able to provide a cheaper technology than the Western companies, companies from the US and companies from Europe. This again has made many people to be attracted in the region. And therefore, then we are saying that this trade, the economic relationship between the countries of the East and the countries of Africa, then provide an opportunity, a very, very important opportunity for the people of Africa, because they provide an alternative. If these people are only dealing with companies from Europe and companies from the USA, then things would be much more difficult. And therefore, the fact that countries of the East are giving the companies from Western Europe and the USA some kind of competition provides those poorer countries in Africa with an opportunity probably to make savings, an opportunity also to set their goods elsewhere. So perhaps I'm going to stop there in the interest of time, and the rest perhaps I can respond in terms in a way of discussion. Thank you very much.
That was Kinutu and Choki. We'll take all the papers, but there are some points to note that he has emphasized. The relationship between Kenya and India, what are the issues? Patterns of this relationship, trading items and all that. You may wish to also keep at the back of your mind issues relating with who benefits more and who is at the losing end. Is it a win-win situation, or there are situations where some persons are benefiting mutually from the trading relations? We also need to bear in mind the trend in the relationship right from the 40s, what has been the trend, and how can you use this to actually do an objective analysis of Kenyan, Indian-Kenyan relationship, especially in contemporary times. I will quickly invite Odari to be doing a paper on the Third Scramble for Africa, a comparative analysis of the Chinese, Indian and Brazilian relations with Africa. You have 15 minutes.
My name is
Katrina.
I'm a
master's
student at the University of Miami. therefore was trying to figure out how the African countries position themselves in a way that can benefit them. They more or less mutually benefit them. And so in my paper I tried to explore the historical background of African relationships with China and India, the challenges and the characteristics, the challenges and the way forward in this relationship. The salience of natural resources, market and labor dates back to the mercantile period of the 15th century. The global expansion of European powers and the subsequent interstate rivalry were based on access, appropriation, or denial of resources, both nationally and internationally. Unfortunately, Africa has always been the object of plundering from the outside world throughout history. The abolition of slave trade, followed by a period of imperialism and colonialism, were both designed in a way to exploit African resources and human labor. European industrialization and need for raw materials engendered this in the imperialist scramble for Africa. Its economic potential had European powers compete to acquire promising territories, which led to the Berlin Conference of the 1884-85. At the conference, the African nations were subdivided into various spheres of European influence, later to be subjected to brutal colonization, particularly in the settler economies like Kenya, Algeria, and Zimbabwe. The freedom struggles and the subsequent colonization led to the creation of independent states that were still dependent on their former colonial masters. The Cold War, too, apart from its ideological facet, had global access to raw materials and energy as one of its key elements. At the end of the Cold War, the restructuring of the world order, where the US emerged as the superpower, also saw the United States interested in African markets and resources, and thus led to the adoption of the African Growth and Opportunity Act, the famous AGOA. This was an initiative whose objective was to enhance trade between the US and Africa. It has, however, continued to benefit the US more than the Africans. The trade volume mainly consists of exporting American manufactured high-tech goods and machinery and importing oil and strategic minerals. The Europeans, also in an attempt to access African markets, formed the Economic Partnership Agreement. From the 20th century, Africa has experienced a new rush for its resources to Brazil and Japan, to some extent, in exchange for aid, trade, and investment in the continent. Some critics have argued that China's foreign aid to the continent is relatively unrelated to its need for resources. One critic is Max Rainbow, who argued that China is filling the areas that the Western foreign aid has neglected. This includes infrastructure, industrialization, and manufacturing. Basically, what the point it tries to put across is that the Western countries mainly focus on social development, like the promotion of human rights and democracy, while they neglect infrastructural development. Historically, China and India's interactions with Africa have been commercial-based without detriment to the continent compared to the West. There are evidences of China-Africa trade, especially at the east coast of Africa. They left a legacy of trade in Chinese silk, porcelain, Indian jewelry, and textiles in exchange for African iron, gold, salt, and ivory. From the late 17th century, small numbers of Chinese immigrants had begun arriving in small numbers in the Cape Colony of South Africa, either as laborers or merchants. The discovery of diamond in 1867 and gold in 1886 in the Transvaal Cape Colony and shortage of African labor necessitated the passage of Transvaal Labor Importation Ordinance, which led to the introduction of Chinese indentured labor into South Africa. During the Indian Ocean trade, some African slaves and merchant sailors found their way to India in small numbers. A number of the freed slaves elevated themselves to positions of authority, while the sailors converted to Islamic established kingdoms in Western India as early as 1100 AD. They came to be known as the Sindhis. They were known to be aggressive and were therefore employed as security forces for Muslim fleets for many centuries. The Brazil's historical connection with Africa, and as we all know, it's more slavery, during the period of slave trade and slavery. Since the abolition of slave trade, Brazil has not had proper foreign policy strategy towards Africa until the presidency of Lula da Silva. One scholar by the name Barbosa has argued that Lula's government's renewed interest in Africa is driven by three main objectives: the South-South diplomacy as a means of strengthening global leadership, Brazil's bid for UN Security Council seat, and the biofuel agenda. China and India, on the other hand, have relations with African countries in the colonial and cold war period. China, for instance, has had episodic engagements with Africa from the opening of official ties with Egypt in 1956, intense activity in the 60s and 70s, followed by a period of neglect in the 80s and renewed interest in the late 90s. India had political relations with African countries during the struggle for independence. While China was among the few non-African states that extended support to Angolan freedom fighters. During the Cold War, India was one of the countries that pioneered the formation of Line-Aligned Movement, which provided the new independent states with an alternative to the East-West power bloc to Cold War politics. The relationship between these countries and Africa are therefore not new. What is new is the level, scope, and the significance of their relationships. China's engagements in Africa have been expanding rapidly compared to India and Brazil. It has aggressively sought African markets and natural resources in response to the needs of an industrializing economy. In return, Africa has an opportunity to equally renegotiate the rules and modes of contract of a large number of international actors who for long have dominated resource extraction in Africa. This is expounding resource nationalism in Africa, while equally raising substantive questions on how much Africa should demand for the resources. It is this aspect that is generating opportunities for African states, allowing them to demand better bargains. And these engagements, China has had engagements with Africa from the 1963 and a couple of meetings, international conferences, and visits carried out by Chinese officials whose visits are seen as entrenching their relationship. These engagements, critics of argued, have been characterized by singular focus on resource acquisition and commercial opportunities. According to the World Bank, trade between Africa and China has grown at more than 40% per year since the year 2000, reaching to about 107 billion in 2008. This makes China the third largest trading partner of Africa after the United States and France. In 2006, Angola overtook Saudi Arabia as the leading exporter of oil to China. Chinese foreign direct investment in Africa is also growing rapidly, topping 5.4 billion in 2008, and more than 1,500 Chinese companies and businesses have invested in Africa, with tens of thousands of Chinese businessmen and laborers trooping to Africa every year. In addition, China has contributed significantly towards African infrastructural development. India and Brazil too have been competing for the same resources, making Africa an object of external interest once more. However, China is still leading in this activity. A large number of African states continue to be plagued by multiplicity of nation-state crises. The crisis of participation, institutional penetration in the society, resource distribution and allocation, and conflict management and resolution. The leadership's inability to respond to this has engendered armed conflicts in several states, just as meaningful attempts to resolve some of the conflicts are taking place. It is notable that a large part of the state crisis is basically a function of the state design and indeed its inability to function as an entity. The situation has not been helped by economic and political pressures exogenous to the continent. In the decade of the 90s, many African states found themselves in projects that implement economic and political liberalizations, whose main objective was to anchor privatization and market liberalization of state economic spaces. While this engendered multipartism, it had far-reaching effects in weakening the state's provisioning capacities in social, political, and economic realms. China, on the other hand, adheres to the five principles of peaceful coexistence and does not interfere with internal affairs of African countries. It supports African countries to independently choose their political systems and development paths suited to their own national conditions. The evolution of China into an alternative source of aid and political support in defiance of Western conditionalities has come to be appreciated by many African leaders. For example, one Ethiopian diplomat in Beijing once stated that if a G8 country had wanted to build a stadium, for example, we would still be holding meetings. The Chinese just come to do it. They don't start to hold meetings about environmental impact assessment, human rights, bad governance, and good governance. I'm not saying that is right. I'm just saying Chinese investment is succeeding because they don't set high benchmarks. African countries, the challenges that African partnership with China is facing is like lack of proper leadership that can effectively engage their trading partners, marked by corruption, nepotism, tribalism, inefficiency, irresponsibility. African governments tend to concentrate on ways of acquisition and maintenance of power and status quo to the extent of neglecting their responsibilities. The importation of substandard goods into the country could easily be avoided if authority were firm and focused on implementing rules on importation. Other aspects of other challenges is African governments have failed to engage these Chinese companies on rules of importation and, an aspect that is increasingly becoming an issue of focus in sub-Saharan Africa is treatment of African workers under Chinese enterprises. A large number of Chinese enterprises, especially those dealing with construction and textile production, have been accused of human rights violation. A large number of these firms are said to contravene labor regulations with impunity. For Kenya, for example, in Kenya, despite the existing labor framework under the regulations of Wages and Conditions of Employment Act, which covers work-related issues such as remuneration and working conditions, minimum wages. A brief conclusion, even though there is givings about Chinese firms, conditions of work, quality of goods, and environmental concerns, the drive for investment has not been stemmed. Additional exploration and search for minerals and trade is still ongoing. The critical question here is that of what form this should take, notwithstanding their source, the need to develop an aid investment and trade index to structure and ensure respect of protocols, goods, and standards to the benefit of communities and states is paramount for any meaningful development.
That was very, very quickly talking points. You need to understand the whole idea of a thought scrum. What does it really mean, and how does it explain the context of Chinese, Indian, and Brazilian relationship with Africa?
Incidentally, the two ladies here defeated the men of the IT. It took 3 minutes. I will just very briefly talking points on Olusegun's paper. There is a need to understand what the real problem is with rising, what looks like an emerging interest of Asia in Africa. What is the nature of this emerging relationship, and how would that affect the development of Africa? And then the third one would be to look at the prospects of this relationship, especially in the context of neoliberal-driven globalization process. These are issues. All the three papers are tied together, you know, emerging interests in Africa, particularly from Asia. I will invite questions in two parts, and possibly three parts if we have time. So we'll take the first round and then go. So you, and then her. We'll take the first round.
Question.
Yes.
One, what was the Yes.
2 minutes to respond, then we take the next set of questions. So start with 2 minutes. When you try and get that view, because it's a very important to me. Advantage because of that gray area, and
in our own institutions in Africa. And this is why India or China or any other country, for that matter, will take advantage. If you are able to strengthen these institutions, then we will not talk about exploitation, etc., etc. And for your information, sometimes it is our own business people who go to China or who go to India, and they demand for the cheapest of quality. So, institutions here, we need to make sure that governance is up to.
I'm going to try to use my 2 minutes very judiciously. Dr. Nsongo, I think it's really interesting that you bring up Sudan because China is now saying it's going to participate in these sanctions against Libya and is participating everything to do with Libya. And this is a really big change in Chinese policy in Africa. And I think that's something worth talking about more if anybody else has anything to say. Dr. Katembo, regarding Zambia particularly, but throughout the whole region and really throughout Africa, there's a few issues involved. And you can take sort of what I'm saying, and if it's a problem in Zambia, it's a really big problem in the DRC, for instance, because there's no government control. Safety and quality. Safety is abysmal in Chinese minds in Zambia. The quality of the roads and buildings they build are a lot like Chinese quality of roads and buildings, and anybody that's been there knows that they don't do a very good job building things. They just rebuild them 2 years later. You can't necessarily, if you build something in Africa and then you leave, there's nobody to rebuild it in 2 years. There's a lot of labor issues involved. I don't know if any of you remember in October the workers that got shot by the Chinese mine owners in Zambia. So that's a big problem. And as for race issues, there are very big race issues between Chinese and Zambians in particular. And I actually attended one of the FOCAP cultural exhibitions in China when I lived there, and they treated a lot of this African dance and art as spectacle still, because it's just not understood properly. So there are a lot of cultural issues as well, not just political and economic ones, although that's where I focus on. And this young woman in the front, I don't know your name, but I think an important country to look at in terms of that's had an advantage, not just over China, but over the whole world, is Botswana. They didn't take any of the structural adjustment programs in the 80s, and they've sort of done everything on their own. Granted, they're only 2 million people, so it's a little harder to do in a bigger country. But Namibia is putting a lot of controls in place to keep the Chinese back in their own country. So those are two places to look at in like the last 30 years, and right now, some of these laws Namibia has passed in the last couple months to keep the Chinese at bay.
Thank you very much. We'll take the second round of questions. Is Ode there? He's gone out. So you, take you. So start first with you. Yeah. Start with you. What are your thoughts?
China's coming for the right one knows that, and they're doing that for each country's own. And it
Consulting. That will be the last one. No, no, he declined. He declined.
So responses 1 minute if you have. Otherwise, just go.
I think most of the questions are most of them related to what you have to do with leadership. It all comes down to the leadership. If you have the strategies and the constitutional framework and good leadership, then I guess they'll be able to engage them on all these issues and what you want to really do. It's all about leadership. And the body question of China going on is not only to be a member that even before the body of their program was a gender, that was going on in one episode. It's also a point of reference to find ourselves on the Chinese. But if you look at, if they buy the land, if they will be the rules, I guess that the African leaders tend to look at
issues maybe you need to take off from because we still have some time.
Yeah, I'm also just scribbling for my own notes, but
regarding what, if China, what they say, that's what they do. I actually studied the 1960s. I'm a historian. The rhetoric was the same in the 1960s, same at Mao Zedong that it is today. But China is not the same in 1960 as it is today. It's much more capitalistic, but it's still communist. And I think we have to take into account how different China is, but how they have kept saying the same things about how we were colonized too, we're your partners, we're on the same level. I don't think anyone can say that Malawi and China are on the same economic level in the world. That's not fair. Which brings me to my second point. World trade, should Malawi try to be selling its grain to Brazil, or should they be selling their grain to regionally? And I think that some of these African economic regional cooperations should be more of the focus for trade. Investment is a completely different idea. Like, it's, are Chinese or American companies or multinational corporations investing on the African continent? That's one thing. But actual trade of goods, import and export, I think that institutions like ECOWAS or SADC are doing a better job of creating trade that makes more sense, because Zambia or Malawi or any of those countries can't really compete in a global market with their products, but maybe they can compete on a regional level instead. Those are my 2 points.
Right. Let me, before I end the session, I'll just say a few things. Whether we like it or not, China is in Africa. Whether it's for the benefit of Africans or the benefit of the Chinese is entirely a matter of you have to really, you know, continue to debate. Because, of course, China is about one of the fastest growing economies in this century. But that bearing that in mind, we also need to be very careful. Like Professor Sati was pointing out, African countries really need to do a deep introspection, and their leaders here will have to be the people that will resolve this matter. For centuries, right from the 15th century, Africa has played a particular role, particularly marginal role in the international system. What do we in the international economy? What can we do? Even in the last century, Africa was at the periphery, you know, of what was happening in the world. In the 21st century, what can we say about Africa? And I think this debate will go on. But bear at the back of your mind, the Chinese are not in Africa because they are motivated by some altruistic, you know, disposition. They are there to make